Let's open our Bibles quickly to Romans. There's so much that the Holy Ghost is sharing with us, but as we said, here we know that when the Lord speaks to us, we're not in a hurry, even if we have to go into next service. I love that about God, that we're just obedient and we don't finish tonight. He just allows us to come back next day and or the Sunday, the service, next service, and get in the Word, right? The fourth chapter of Romans, fourth chapter, verses 12. I'm going to call this again, faith at work always. Say with me, faith at work always. Faith is always working, just like Andrew, would you give me a little bit more, just a little bit? I don't know why I'm not hearing. Y'all guys hearing, right? Okay, maybe it's the monitor system. Anyway, thank you, sir. Faith is always working. Gravity will never change. You cannot change the law of gravity. God, I thank God for gravity. Amen. What goes up has to come down. Amen. And so thank God. Some people may not like gravity, especially when they're getting a little older. You're right? You know? And so, but anyway, gravity's working all the time, right? But the thing about gravity, it was made by the law of faith. So gravity is just a representation of faith always working. You don't see gravity, you sure don't see faith, but you believe faith, right? You believe faith. So in other words, faith is always working, and so the just shall live by faith. Now, let's look at something. Go with me to the fourth chapter. We're going to stay most of the time in the fourth chapter, so put a marker there, and then we're going to jump around to different scriptures. But Romans, the fourth chapter, verses 12, and the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had, being yet uncircumcised. Understand something here, that for some reason we think that, I thank God for the Jewish people. I love them. We bless them. But we understand something, that it was through their working that God had with them, they were able to have what God's given them. And Jesus came first to the Jew, but we also know that now the Gentile. And thank God that we were once Gentile. We got saved. Thank God for that, right? Can you imagine if it wasn't for us, dear Lord, what would we do, Brother Bo? But he loved us so much. So he's telling us right now, he says it's not just for the circumcision or the circumcised ones, the Jewish people, but it was even before the uncircumcision of Abraham. But he said something so clear. The Holy Spirit just brought something out here, and I want you to underline it. And let me read it to you from the Good News Bible. We are those that walk in the steps of the faith of Abraham. The Bible says he is also the father of those who are circumcised, that is, of those who, in addition to being circumcised, also live the same life of faith that our father Abraham lived before he was circumcised. So we are those people that have to remember the steps of faith. But not only to remember the steps of faith, but we have to walk in them. They're steps of faith made for us to walk in. How many people have ever walked in the steps of others in a snowstorm? I've been in blizzards. I know what that is. I know how it is to walk in the woods, in the wilderness, following steps that help you find your way out. And so it's so beautiful when you realize, spiritually speaking, and thank you, Holy Ghost, spiritually speaking, those steps have been made deep and heavy and big for us to see. So we have to remember that. So the just shall live by faith. So in other words, hold your finger there and go with me to the verse. Verse chapter 4. Well, we were at 4, right? Verses 16 now. Let's just go there for a moment. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end, that the promise might be sure to all thy seed, that's us, the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Say with me, he's the father of us all. Faithful Abraham. But now notice this, it is the faith that is by grace. Yeah. Now remember, what is grace? But what is grace? Real loud, quickly. Unmerited favor. The ability of God coming on you to do what you cannot do. And then what Kenneth Copeland says is God's overwhelming love towards you to treat you like you've never sinned. That's grace. I like that too, right? I like that too. But I kind of like the one I composed. Faith is, grace is God's ability to come on you to do what you cannot do for yourself. That's simple what it is. So let's just get deep right into grace message, right? So it's a beautiful thing, right? Now notice this. So in other words, hold your finger there and go with me to Ephesians. Ephesians. How many people know that? You know you can't do it on your own. It's going to take grace. Say with me, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's going to take grace. Grace, grace. So let's look at Ephesians, the second chapter. We're going to come back, go hold your finger at Romans. Let's just go to get some foundational why it is by grace. The second chapter, verses 8, underline it. It says, listen to what it says. For by grace, God's ability, you are saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God. So in other words, the gift of God is the grace that comes through faith. Come on, church. Can you say amen? So I want you to think about this. Faith is like that big tube that grace has to come through. That's why you and I need to live by faith every day. You need that tube of faith. Because when you have the tube of faith, and I'm using to make it an illustration to see. I want you to see this tube. Well, let's look at this pipe going to your house, a pipe. It comes from the meter, the main city line, and it goes to your house and you control the flow of that, right? But really, it's a powerful flow coming to your house. It really is. And it has a meter out there, a valve that doesn't really push that water to explode the pipes. So it controls it, but still, it still is controlled because you have the ability to turn it full blast or low. So in other words, this is the way grace operates. It wants to flow. God's ability on you wants to flow. And you have to have that tube like that pipe of faith, faith working, but don't shut that valve off. Keep faith moving through you. Keep that grace moving through that pipe of faith. So in other words, the more that you use faith, the more the faith increases and the more the pressure of the Holy Spirit comes and brings you that grace, which is the ability of God to do which you cannot do on your own. See, you cannot do what you've done already, only but by the grace of God. You couldn't get saved by your own. You needed the grace of God, right? You couldn't be here today but by the grace of God. So you might as well enjoy the grace and expand the capacity. Come on, church. Expand the capacity of faith to flow greater in you. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Let's go back. Let's go back to Romans now. So it is by faith that the just shall live. So in other words, faith is now a picture of some great things that are happening. Amen. Look at verses 17 now. And I love this. And so hang in there, church, about this. As it is written, circle or underline, as it is written. Underline that. As it is written. Now let's just stop here. As it is written is the word of God. As it is written. In the court of law, when you go to court, they don't go by what they think. They go by what was written, what was already set in motion, and by the laws of the land, the law books, and then things that took place. So in other words, what is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him who you believed, even God who quickened the dead and calleth those things which do not, those things which be not as though they were. So let's look at something as it is written. All right, you want to see that? And notice this, remember, the Spirit of God is sharing through the epistle or the Roman letter what Abraham had to understand, and Abraham understood something because it was written. So in other words, you and I understand the Word because it's written by the Holy Ghost. As it is, tell me, as it is written. Tell your neighbor, as it is written. That's why it's so important to understand faith cometh, faith cometh, faith cometh, faith cometh by watching television. No, 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 no. Faith cometh by eating a big hamburger. No, 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 no. Faith cometh by altogether by the hearing of the word of God. So faith cometh, right? Say with me, faith cometh. Well, let's do a little history lesson and go, hold your finger there or put your marker there. Better put your marker there. Let's go to Genesis, the 17th chapter. I was reading Genesis, and I love the Holy Spirit reminds us what happened. And so this is no different than you. This is no different than what he's telling you, right? And you're going to get excited about something here. Genesis, the 17th chapter. Now, remember, we just left where Romans is talking about Abraham. Say, Abraham.
Abraham.
Now, notice this. And when Abram, it's amazing that this name now is a different person, a different name.
Yeah.
And Abram was 90 years and 90, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Lord Almighty God, walk before me and be thou perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and I will multiply thee exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Come on, church, can you say amen?
Amen.
So this is why it said in Romans, as it is written. But now notice this. This is why it's written for us to know. As it is written in the Word of God, God declared it. And so understand it. When he declared it, it is a first word spoken.
Yeah.
Now remember, I love first word spoken because first word spoken means God means it.
Yeah.
Say with me, God means it.
God means
and so hold this thought here for a moment. Whenever there is a first word from God, first word spoken, it is a word of command. Whenever there's a word, first word spoken. So whenever God speaks to you, understand it's a command. Second of all, he will fulfill that command by supporting that command. Understand something. And what happens in life is we try to reason that word, and then that word fades away, and then we think it wasn't God. But if you'll go back to what the Lord said the first time, stay with it. I don't care if you haven't heard anything from God. Should I move on hearing nothing? No, you stay on what you heard God say. You build a foundation on the first word. First word, first word. Say it'll be first word. Come on, church, first word. Amen. And so that's what happened here. But notice this. I want you to see something. In chapter 16, verses 15, just two verses above chapter 17, and Hagar bare Abraham a son, and Abraham called his son's name, which Hagar bare Ishmael. And Abraham was 80 years old when Hagar bare Ishmael to Abraham. Wrong, 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 wrong. He messed up. He was 86 years old. So if you take away 86 from 99, what does it make it, Sinji? 13 years. 13 years he did not hear from God.
Wow.
You know, it is a long time, but that's when you and I have to hang on to that word.
Yeah.
Those years that you want to give, if you hold on to it. So in other words, we're learning from Abraham. So in other words, he got so anxious, or his wife Sarai, got so anxious that she says, well, you know, I'm old. I'm old, so go ahead and we have a house person here that you can go ahead and fulfill that desire that God said he'll do for you. Wrong, 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 wrong. God still remember that word. First word always wins. First word always wins. And I'm trying to encourage you about something. We don't have to go in life wondering, did I miss it? No, you stay with what first God said. First word says it all. You stay on it. And Pastor Osi said many years ago, he says, you know what? You don't need to hear from God the second time if you're not obeying the first word. If you don't obey that first word, don't expect God to speak to you the seventh time. It could be 13 years later. Ooh, Jesus. Amen. It's a long time. Amen. It may be 13 years later. So in other words, listen to this. It's written because God spoke it. Write that down. It's written because God spoke it. So in other words, you and I, and write this down, be assertive with his will, write this down, be assertive with his purpose and his promises. Remember, his word, which was the first time, it's his will. Remember, his word that was the first time is his promise. Be assertive. Be aggressive in standing in that word. Don't be a wishy-washy Christian wavering back and forth. Know that you know that you know that you know that you know God spoke to me. And I don't need another new word that's going to confuse what I first heard. See, people are looking from words from people rather than God. I've had people say, well, Pastor, give me a word. No, I ain't going to give you a word. God's got to give you a word. Amen. I'll give you a word to go. Go sit down somewhere. Amen. But it's got to be God has got to give you that word, right? So in other words, be assertive with the will of God. I want you to say with me right now and say it boldness. I know God's word. I know His will. I know His purpose. And I know His promise. Say it again. I know His will. I know His will. I know His purpose. I know His promise. For me. Forever. Amen. And see, this is the way we're going to live. The just shall live by faith. Now, let me just add something. If somebody comes to you and says, thus saith the Lord, and it's totally contradictive what you got from the Lord, you better not take that word as gold. But Pastor, what if I miss it? No. Listen, God wants you to hear His voice. Now, I lived through many, many movements. The Jesus movement, the shepherd movement, the prophetic movement, and everyone had a flaw. But there was a Jesus, there was a shepherd movement that was dangerous. A shepherd movement where the pastor told you who to get married to. Pastor told you where to live. Pastor told you what to buy. Pastor told you what to give. And it became, I lived through that, but I never was under it, but I heard people. It was a fad. It was a spiritual fad. T.L. Osborne says that this type of history repeats itself over some time. So what you're living today and what you're seeing today, it's nothing new. It happened 20, 25 years ago. That grace message that hit the church 2 years ago, 3 years ago, that sloppy grace message, it's nothing new. It happened 25, 30 years ago. And so this is why you have to realize that. That's why it's so good to study historians that are spiritual leaders in the church. Study them. Read books. I love reading books of great men of God that lived through, like Till Osborne, Oral Roberts, and all these great men. You learn so much because you see what they went through, and it's nothing new today. So you're not caught off guard, right? So in other words, I just threw that in there for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now notice this. Hold your finger there. So in other words, be assertive. Okay. Now write this down. God responds to our desire in His word. God responds to your desire when it's based upon the word. I want you to think about that. Don't ever assume that God doesn't want the best for you. He's desiring the best for you. Don't ever think, well, you know, well, I guess it's not God's intention to have that. I guess I got to suffer for having. No. You're a child of the living God. Hallelujah. Dad is your daddy. Hallelujah. Amen. So you believe great things. Hallelujah. But the problem here, it's not God not releasing it. The problem is your pipe of faith is not flowing right. It's not why. You got to get a Holy Ghost, a plumber to go in there and fix these things. Amen. Amen. What do they call it? A rotor-rooter. Go on. Get that flow. Hallelujah. Amen. Hold your finger there. Go back. Let's look at chapter 15 now of Genesis. Look at chapter 15 of Genesis. Amen. Chapter 15 of Genesis. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, Father, so good. Can you say amen? He's so good. 15. And the Bible says in verses 1, and after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram. Remember, he's still Abram. In a vision saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. Say with me, great reward. I want you to think about it. He's your great reward. He is your father and he has everything in him. Now notice this. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless? And the steward of my house is this Eleazar of Damascus. And so in verses 3 it says, and Abram said, behold, to me thou hast given me no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. So all Abraham had to do is hear first word. Yeah. He got a little anxious. Yeah. First word always wins. You can't go wrong with first word. So in other words, the next chapter we just read in chapter 17, where he paid the price for bringing Ishmael into the world. Ishmaels are dangerous, church. Stay away from Ishmael dreams, Ishmael promises. Ishmael. you know what I'm talking about? No. Did I say it right? Ishmael's?
Yeah, Ishmael.
Isaac is good. Okay, I thought about it because I saw you looking deep, and I said, okay, did I say it right? Amen. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Amen. Ishmael is not good. Look at your neighbor. Ishmael's no good. And study this chapter. You'll find out. Can I give you a little history lesson here?
Sure.
The deal that we're having today, this holy war that's happening, which they don't want to say it's a holy war. It's a spiritual war. It's the deal with Ishmael. Ishmael and Isaac. That's what it is. Read this chapter. Read this chapter about Ishmael. That's what we're dealing with. But yet God still blessed this Ishmael, this family, because the thing about that was Abraham did it out of ignorance. And yet for the sake of the child, for the sake of the mama, he wanted to bless them. So we're dealing with it now. So don't get caught up in altogether Ishmael. Look at your neighbor. Don't get caught up in Ishmael. I'm telling you, that's the most dangerous thing to do. So in other words, first word always brings. Go back to Romans now. Did you get something right there? I think the Holy Ghost spoke solid there. Amen. Listen. He got too anxious. And go back to Romans. I told you to put a marker there. And listen to what it says. In verses 17, as is it written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before whom he believed, even God who calleth or quickens the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they are. Look at that word, God calleth. Now I'm going to tell you something. I want you to think about this. God doesn't calleth any less than what he declares. When God calls, he summons. And I want you to write this down. When God summons, and I'm going to say it slow. When God summons, he declares. In other words, right here it says, and God calleth those things. And when God declares, he commands. I'm telling you, when he commands, you just say, yes, sir. Now, you have the choice to choose. You can say, no, sir. But it's really hard to say no, sir, when you hear the word of the Lord so clear. Yes, sir. So in other words, he commands things. Now, listen to this. He commands things that you see nothing of. In other words, he calls things. In other words, before he called in the earth, it wasn't. And if you lived, you didn't see it. But you didn't live because you were made out of something that he commanded. So in other words, he's giving you something here. Call those things in. But in order for you to have the same command, the same declaration, and the same purpose, then you've got to hear the word of the Lord. That's why he says, Jesus said, you can tell this mountain to be cast into the sea and it shall obey you. But see, the people are not understanding that because they don't understand the command. They don't understand the word. They don't understand the spoken word. Now they'll see you move mountains and they'll say, I want to move a mountain, but they can't. Because see, now once we develop God's word in us, first word is a powerful word. Now we speak the command like God. And listen to this. In the unseen world, angels respond to God's command through you. God commands, angels respond to the command of God through you. They're not going to obey. Now listen to what I'm going to say. It will be wrong for us to say, well, God commands the angels over me. No, it doesn't say that. He gives you command over these angels. Now the thing about that is this, we can fall into a spiritual low if we start thinking that God is in charge of everything. And we're just people that have to flow with the flow. And that's who people teach. Do you know that people teach that? They say, well, whatever God wills. I've heard people say, whatever God wills, it's his will. You know, if he wants me sick, then he wants me sick. If he wants, you know, let's get real. You have the command, as long as you know the word, as it is written. You have the command, as long as you know the written word of God. The written word of God is powerful. Amen. So in other words, faith is activated in you by that command. When you have faith, the Spirit of God moves in there. The anointing of God moves in there. You command, you lay hands on the sick. He says, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So in other words, you go with a command of God's word. I speak healing in Jesus' name. And the command that is in that word, as it is written, establishes by faith what's being done. And that's the most easiest thing, is just walk away and say, thank you, Lord, you did it. Amen. Well, I don't see it. No, you're not supposed to see it, because you're not created to see it in the natural. You're created to see it in the spiritual first. Spiritual first, right? And so I want you to close your eyes. Everybody here, I have something that I want you to think about. Close all your eyes. Close everybody's eyes. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, I want you to see Jesus right now. See Jesus. Now, I'm talking about, this is not mind over matter. This is just an example. See Jesus. I want you to see his face from the chin up to his forehead. I want you to see him. Ooh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I thank you. Oh, open your eyes. Did you see Jesus? Now, if I ask sister, how was his face? And she may say, he was just beautiful. All right. Well, tell me more about him. Well, he just didn't have a smile. Just looked straight. And then another, I would ask her, she said, he was just looking at me like with authority. Okay. Bo says, I saw him just laughing. And then I asked him, Dima, how do you see Jesus? Well, I see him just in pain. Okay, so see now, why do we see Jesus that way? Because someone already painted that picture in you to see it. Hollywood's painted a picture of how Jesus looks. A lot of us see Jesus on that cross still. He's not on the cross no more. I've been to homes where Jesus is still on the cross and he's like this. And they're saying, oh, isn't that beautiful? I says, no, it's not. That's not the picture of Jesus. Now notice this. Let me tell you something now. You have to go by the unseen in your spirit, not by somebody else's picture painted for you. So that means now you have to start getting the visual, or the purpose and the vision of Jesus, the way Holy Spirit shows Jesus to you. Don't see him through the cross. Don't see him carrying that thorn of crowns and that blood on him and dead. Don't see that. Don't see that. You start getting that. You start seeing Jesus. I have in my mantle in my home, and I should have brought it. I told Christina to remind me, I wanted to bring it. I was in Branson, and there was this artist selling the picture of Jesus, and there was a picture of Jesus just laughing. And I said, I want that picture. And he asked me, why do you want this picture of Jesus? He said, because see, this is actually the picture that Jesus looks like when he showed me Jesus. He's laughing. Oh! Laughing over the enemy. That's the way I see Jesus. That's why I see Jesus loving God. Oh! I don't see Jesus like Hollywood did that. You know what I'm talking about? So in other words, this is from the unseen. I've seen Jesus this way. So when I bought that picture, it was quite expensive, but I love it. And I have it in my mind. It's a beautiful picture. I'll bring it. You just have to remind me. Text me somebody. Amen. And it's a beautiful picture. Amen. And everybody that sees that picture, they say, wow, I never seen Jesus that way. That's the way I've seen him. I'm telling you, that author or that artist would have made millions if you know, but I'm telling you, anyway. Hallelujah. Amen. So in other words, he summons, he calls those things be not as they all they were. Can you say amen? He calls them things. Now, in other words, we have to renew our mind daily by this understanding. Renew our mind daily. I'm calling this in now in Jesus' name. You're calling it in by renewing your mind daily. You're saying it daily. So in other words, what are you doing? Now you're getting faith to operate in your heart to see things that God wants you to see. So that you can have that first word. Amen. That first word. I see it. I see it. I see it. Say with me, I see it. I see it. I see it. Can you say amen? Amen. Now notice this. Verses 18 says, who against hope believed in hope. I'm going to tell you something. Hope is not, like I said, Sunday, it's not a wishing well. Hope is a God picture inside of you by the Holy Ghost. Hope is a dream that God has given you by the Holy Ghost. That first word he put in you, it's a dream, it's a word, it has power and authority. It's called that in. It's not a wishing well. In fact, hope is absolute. It's an absolute. Say with me, it's an absolute.
It's an absolute.
It's a guarantee without any doubt. And so really the meaning of it in Hebrew is to expect or anticipate with pleasure. I want you to think about, I have hope and I'm expecting it with an with expectation, with anticipation, hope. It's not. Now, this is what happened here. He, look at it again. The word here, and that word is who against hope. This is what happens to us. We give up. You have a dream. You have a vision. But you get the circumstances, and you start seeing the circumstances. It'll never happen. And mama or daddy will tell you it'll never happen, or sister or brother or someone or boss. You have to put aside all those negatives and say, no, but I see it in my spirit. I believe it. I have hope. I have an expectation. I know I got a guarantee from the spoken word of God. It's going to happen. I don't care how long it takes. God's going to do it. And it's going to happen. Amen. I'm telling you, this is where you don't lose hope. You hold on and hold on and hold on. Besides all the circumstances that are out there. Can you say that? So you have to believe first. Now listen to this. You got to believe first in the unseen, so that it can manifest in the natural. A lot of us want to see it first, then believe. It's not faith. And God would never operate that way. God can't give Sarai a child and you change her name as Sarah without them experiencing faith, calling those things in. And let me just say something. Abraham means the father of many nations. So when God changed Abraham's name from Abram, He said, you're going to be a father of many nations, so I'm giving you a name. So in other words, He painted a vision to Abraham that you're going to be a father of many nations. Now your name shall no longer be called Abram, but it should be called Abraham, father of many nations. Do you know what that meant to him as he walked around? No, I'm not Abraham. I'm not Abram. No. I'm Abraham. You're 99 years old. How are you going to be? Well, see, they knew what Abraham meant. Father of many nations. How are you going to be a father of many nations? God said it. You're 99 years old. By the time you have a child, you're going to be 100. And your wife, Sarah, dear Lord, she's old. So he changed her name too. She had a dream. She had a vision. Of course, she laughed about it. And ha, 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 ha. Yeah, she laughed about it. But who got the last laugh? God got the last laugh. You see, so the thing about that was he saw this. And so in other words, he believed first by the picture, Abraham. I want you to say with me, I believe first by faith that I receive it now. Now notice this, I believe first, say it again, I believe first by faith that I receive it. Now close your eyes right now. I want you to see that. Now, this is not mind over matter. I just rebuke that thought, you know. This is getting an inside vision of what God has for you. Yeah. I'm not saying to start meditating on that vision. No. The reason why your eyes are closed is because you see nothing but the Word of God. And this is the attitude we ought to have in the natural. Walking, you can open your eyes now, but walking in the Spirit, seeing by the Spirit of God. I'm not moved by what I see. I'm moved by what I see in the Spirit, in the unseen. I'm moving by what I see. I see myself blessed. I see myself the head, not the tail. I see myself coming in blessed and going out blessed. I see myself wealthy, full of God, anointed of God, full of the glory of God. You see, this is what you've got to start seeing yourself. And when you start thinking, well, I'll never have it, that's when you need to switch over quicker into the unseen world. Come on, church. Amen. Okay, hold your finger there. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen. Now, notice what it says. Go with me to Mark 11. That's where we are always with people of faith. That's our foundation. That's who we are. And I want you to memorize this. I memorize this scripture. I love speaking to those mountains. One brother said, Brother, Just try to go around that mountain. No. That's not what the Bible said. He said, speak and it should be removed. Mark 11, the 11th chapter, verses 23. Are you guys okay? It says, for Jesus said this. So in other words, it's read, written in power. Verses 22, Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. Have the faith of God. You already know you have it, right? You already know that you have it. We have the faith of God. For verily I say unto you that whoever shall say unto this mountain. Now, you ought to see where he said this mountain. There had to be a proof of a mountain there before Jesus. This mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. So in other words, he's saying, look at this mountain, disciples. Now he's teaching us. Look at this mountain. Look at this mountain. Look at this mountain. It's a big mountain. Don't try to go around it. You believe that you can speak to it, but if you will have faith and don't have doubt, but have faith. Now, doubt is a contamination. It contaminates your faith. It really does. I tell you, I know what doubt does. Doubt always comes in when you hear the first word. Have you ever noticed that? God says that you'll have this and, oh, doubt comes right there and then. Why? Because the enemy doesn't want you to believe what God said. He's the father of lies, and you ought to remember something. He's the father of lies, and in him is doubt. He has no faith. He's doubtful. He's living in doubt. He is the author of doubt. He is the creator. He is literally the creator of doubt, if you want to look at it that way. He is. Amen. And so we have to realize you speak to this mountain. And so listen to what it says in the ASV. Verily I say unto you, whatever shall you say, well, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou taken up and cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that what he saith shall come to pass, he shall have it. I want you to remember that. Whatsoever you say it, whatsoever you say shall come to pass. Now notice this, whatsoever you say, the moment you use doubtful words, that's going to come to pass too. You're living today by what was spoken yesterday. Come on, church. I'm telling you, this is so true. You're living today what was spoken yesterday. So in other words, doesn't it give us greater hope in the Word to start speaking His Word now? Start changing circumstances, start speaking the Word of God. So in other words, we have to speak to that mountain. What is a mountain, Pastor? Well, I like to look at it this way. It's big, right? Yes, it's big. So it's standing in between you and God. That's all it is. Whenever you can't reach something, it's because the mountain is standing between you and God. Now, the thing about faith now speaks to that bigness that you thought was big. And now you see it start diminishing. It starts to dissolve before you. But you got to see it before it happens in the natural. You got to see it. You got to believe it. Hallelujah. Amen. You see, faith will always speak what God is saying. So you got to say what God is saying. Yeah. Come on, church. Amen. I remember early morning prayer years ago. I would open the church up, and I did it for 5 years. Open the church at 5:30 in the morning to get early morning prayer started for 5 years, and I loved it. But notice this. One morning, pastor came in early. He says, I want you to lead prayer, pastor, but I want you to have faith and agree with us that we're going to get. It's happened so many times that I get them all mixed up, but I remember a $30,000 check. Personally, I've received money in different forms or different ways by faith. Now, notice, it's $30,000. We need to believe God, and we need to have it today because we had a school and a lot of things. So, you know, when you have a big overhead, you're believing God every day in faith, every day. And so I got up there, and so, you know, we're praying, and I called a brother and said, would you pray this prayer? And we went ahead and started making a declaration. Father, we thank you that we receive $30,000 today. We thank you that we receive it. Say with me, amen. So we're agreeing. We say amen. So we're people of faith, right? So here people are, little by little, they're leaving to go to work. We're still praying. We go into another area, another stream of faith to pray. And it's a powerful prayer going on. And all of a sudden, this young lady, or this lady left. I seen her leave. And then I seen her come back with an envelope. And I'm still praying. And so literally, I stopped the prayer. And I said, sister, what is it? Come up here. So I handed this envelope to pastor. Pastor's praying. Pastor opens up. She says, pastor did not jump up and say, woo, we got a miracle. He said, amen. Gave me the envelope. And I said, woo, $30,000. Now notice this. Notice what I'm saying. Notice what, and it was a cashier's check, but this is at 6:30 in the morning. Cashier's checks are not made at 6:30 in the morning. There's no bank open. Does anybody know you can get a cashier's check made at 6:30 in the morning? Amen. I mean, really, let's be sincere, right? Nobody could have left that building and went to get a $30,000 check. Couldn't be. So the thing that was so obvious was God already touched someone's heart the day before. Touched the heart already. So in other words, he was already moving way ahead of us. But you said we agreed. Yeah, but you got to understand something. My pastor had already agreed. He just wanted us to continue believing with him in faith. So in other words, I learned something. I learned something so powerful that God did something supernatural. Brought in what faith was demanding through grace, brought it in and crossed every limitation of time, of bank, of reasoning, of all things. And but now I understood something. I understood why my pastor never got so excited like I did. Because he believed. I'm telling you, isn't that awesome? That's a powerful walk of faith. That's why we need, and I know what you mean by miracles. Well, it's a miracle. Well, you ought to write this down. A miracle is simply the way it should be. It's a miracle to you because you might have had a little doubt. Oh, it's a miracle. Amen. And I try to be like a pastor and say, amen. When we get breakthroughs in our house or in our life, and Pastor says, amen, it happened. Amen. Because, see, your words are solid. Amen. Let it be solid, right? Now, we get excited. We get excited about things. Hallelujah. I remember coming back from a pastor's meeting in January of 2015. And I remember driving my car, and my daughter texts me and says, Daddy, why don't you come through Dallas and try that route, see if you like it. So I never do. I always go through Fort Worth. And so this day I decided to go through Dallas, and I was stuck in traffic, bumper to bumper. I regretted it. But at that time, I regretted it. But in the side of me was a pickup truck. And I looked at that pickup truck, and I said, God, look at that beautiful truck. Christine, look at you. You ought to get one like that. I said, amen. I like it. And I said, no, there's no covenantness here, no covenant. But Lord, I thank you for that. That's a beautiful truck. So in other words, coming home, my faith from that pastor's council is stirring up. Thank you, Father. I'll just call that truck in. Father, I thank you. And this is by this time, I'm already halfway home. So we're saying, Father, we thank you for this truck. We thank you. And she said, Pastor, do you like that color? I said, I like that color. We'll call that color. And so I called it in. I called it in. What did I do? I started speaking it. Getting the picture of it. So what happened? Christine found a picture of that truck that we wanted, cut it out, put it on the refrigerator. So every time I went to the refrigerator, I said, oh, thank you, Lord, for this beautiful truck. I see myself driving it. Come on, church, I'm seeing it. Now I notice this, what am I doing? You may think that's ridiculous, but what's happening? The picture, the first word that God gave me, believe me for it. So I'm believing it. So now I'm getting that picture, and now I'm seeing it, and now I'm calling it. But now what do I got to do? I got to step out in faith and start working faith by looking for this truck. And so to make the testimony right to it, I found this truck on the internet. It came up on the internet, brand new. Well, let me just say this. It's brand new. Bought it at 1,500 miles. Lady bought it in Texas. She moved to Oklahoma. She didn't like it. So she traded it in for a Dodge, and the Dodge dealer had it. And when I found it online, I texted them, and boy, they just started calling me. I said, oh, 3 weeks. 3 weeks went by. The reason why 3 weeks went by, because I've learned in faith, you have to stay in God's timing, because the enemy also knows your desire. So I stayed, and I says, Father, I thank you for this truck. So Lord, I'll purposely look back in 3 weeks. I don't know. The Holy Ghost just told me 3 weeks. I don't know about you, but 3 weeks, brand new vehicles don't last that long on the market, right? Can y'all say amen? Especially trucks. So I looked back on the internet, and it was still there. So I called them. I said, you know what? I'm coming down to look at that truck. Amen. I said, amen. I'm going down there. So we got down there. I kid you not. This is awesome. I'm driving up on a Saturday, and all these dealers are busy, but there's one young man standing out in the driveway, and I pull in and I park my car, and he tells me, park over here. He goes out there, and I'm thinking he's going after me. I'm thinking that. And he said, are you here for that truck? I said, yeah, how'd you know? He said, I just knew you were coming. God already had him waiting for me. All right, so that was the sign. He pulled the truck out. I looked at the truck. This is it. This is it. This is it. And then we talk price. I bit myself. I'm getting this truck. You don't realize that they're giving it to me. Oh, Jesus. Got that truck. I'm telling you what. And I'm telling you, I remember faith was activated and faith happened. And so it's happening. Now remember, the word of the Lord came to us that things are moving faster now. God's coming. It's accelerating. Faith is moving. So we have to understand something. So in other words, he says here, look at it again, verses 23. Verily, I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, he's not saying it's only for pastors. He's not saying it's only for righteous. He's saying for the believer, whosoever. Say, I'm a whosoever. I'm a whosoever. You're a believer. If you're a believer, this entitles you. Whosoever, that's me, say it with me, it's me. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in this heart, but shall believe those things which he saith shall come to pass, and he shall have whatsoever he saith. So in other words, get that vision, get that picture inside of you. Get it inside of you. Now, how do you see what God wants you to see? Good question, right? Pastor, you may say, Pastor, how do I see like you saw that truck? How do I see this? How do I know it's not my flesh? How do I know it's just not something that I just want or I'm coveting? Well, first of all, you can't covet things. First of all, you're coveting something from somebody else. Just get out of it. Just repent. Say, oh, no, I like that, but I don't want that. I like that, but I don't want it. Right. I don't want yours. Exactly. That's why he says you better be careful about coveting. Right. I went to Sinji Bo's house, right? You ought to see, they live in a castle, right? Pastor, President Obama has nothing compared to him. No, say yes. Hey, amen, all right. It's true. God gave you a beautiful. Can you say amen, Bo? It's a beautiful house. Has anybody ever been at Bo's house?
No.
You ought to get a tour when they get back. Amen. Now, I'm telling you, you walk in that door, faith will just jump on you like, yeah, I did too. Amen. When you step in that door, faith jumps on you like a fly on molasses, man. It just jumps on you. Woo, Jesus. It's a big house, man. I get excited. But, I knew them when they didn't have that house. Right, Bo? I knew you when you lived way out there in Hometown, amen. I mean, where you drive and you're shakalada, you're praying and boom, you know, drug sales. You remember that? I remember that house, and that's when I met you. Oh, the testimony that they have.
Wow.
And see what happened? God started working. But notice, as I'm encouraging about something. I remember that they were believing God for a house, and I'll never forget this because it's so powerful. They believed God for a house. They stepped into a house and they stepped into this. They wanted this house. And then I remember Sinji called me a little sad. I think she had a little tear that the house sold. Right, Sinji? The house sold. That house that you were looking at sold. But I remember telling her, hey, no. I said, don't get all messed up about it. Don't get upset or don't feel upset. It could be a stepping stone to build your faith to where God wants you. The very next house, they lived in it how long? 9 or 10 years, and that was a beautiful house, solid house. I guess the owner, he was probably the only owner, right? Solid house, beautiful house, amen? And then from there, they just increased in faith. And now they have this castle. It's a big house. But see, that didn't happen simply by wishing it. It was faith. Exercising faith. So in other words, this is what he's saying here. You say to the circumstance, whatever's in your way, if the circumstances say you can't have it, say, I can have all things. If the circumstances you'll never have it, you say, I can have it now. You speak to it and command that mountain, be removed in Jesus' name. Be removed in Jesus' name. But don't walk away and say, well, I hope it's removed. No, say, thank you, Lord, it's removed, it's removed. Thank you, Lord, hallelujah, thank you. And now exercise your faith like looking for houses. or looking for something. You know, whatever the Lord's telling you, exercise that faith. You know that just about every other day, Christina and I are driving on property. I think I'm putting more miles on my truck just driving to country, looking at home, looking at land, looking for church. I'm asking God, I see the building, God. I see it, but I see it in my spirit, but it's not built yet, Lord. I see it. And now the Lord has me looking in land, and I'm driving, and ooh, Jesus, I'm finding some great lands, and I'm saying, I see hills and valleys, and I see water, I see ponds, and oh, I'm seeing it. So what am I doing? Now I'm exercising my faith by driving and sitting in front of these big lands and dreaming and saying, oh, Jesus, this, tell me, Lord, if this is it, I'll call it in, Lord. I'll call it. This is it, Lord. I got to hear that first word. I got to hear that first word. Now my flesh can say, oh, I like this and I like this. I'll call that in. It'll never happen. I got to hear the word of the Lord. First word always wins. First word is powerful, right? So in other words, get a picture of it and see yourself. Now go back to Romans quickly. Go back to Romans. Are you guys okay?
Yeah.
Verses 19. Yeah. Hallelujah. Verses 19. And being not weak in faith. Do not be weak in faith. He considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving God glory. In verse 21, and he was being fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able to perform it. You've got to have full persuasion. Amen. You've got to walk in this. Listen to this. Write this down. Refuse to be moved by circumstances. Refuse it. I'm not going to be moved by circumstances. If God said it, I see the picture. Now notice this. Let me encourage you. Don't jump out trying to make it happen on your own. See a picture first by the Spirit of God. See the word of the Lord first. Hear the word of the Lord. And you may say, well, Pastor, how do I hear the word of the Lord? Well, I got ahead of myself. But press against all natural circumstances. Press through there. Remember, obstacles and adversities are now being replaced. Remember that obstacles and adversity are just stepping stones for you. An obstacle is just as you go higher to see over it. An adversity is just a big boulder for you to look over the mountain. You see what I'm saying? So don't get caught up. Now notice this is what the Lord told me. Your first step is His step that's going to bring that second step. Your first step. Now you may say, well, I thought it was His first step. No, the first step is the word He gave you. But now you got to take that first step into that word. And then that second step, He has it. You see what I'm saying? You have to, just like when you receive Jesus Christ. How many people receive Jesus Christ? You all are saved, right? How did you do it? By confessing Jesus. I confess you, Lord. That's what you have to do in faith. I confess this right now, the word of the Lord. Amen. So in other words, first word is always powerful. Amen. Now go back to the question is, how do we get a picture, Pastor? How do we get a vision inside of me? How do you see what is not seen? Well, go with me to Hebrews, and then that's going to be the last scripture for today. Go with me to Hebrews. Amen. Hebrews. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Pastor, how do I know the picture? How do I know the picture, Lord? How do I see it? Well, look at verses chapter 12. Go with me to Hebrews 12. Now, this is powerful. And I want you to see this. Pastor, how do I get a picture inside of me? I got so many scrambled pictures. I got so many different things that I want. Well, let's just go first. Let's just do first one thing first. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verses 2. I want you to 2. Looking unto Jesus. That's a big revelation right there. Look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Listen, He's the author and He's the finisher. But you have to look to Him. You got to get your eyes on Jesus. Don't get your eyes on things. Get your eyes on Jesus. Jesus, I want to see you through this. I want to see you through this. I want to see. A person told me the other day, you know, I've learned so much about Jesus. I've learned so much about Jesus. I learned so much about the Word. And the Lord told me to tell that person, well, if you've seen Jesus and learned so much from the Word, then why have I seen Jesus in you? Now, that's a bold statement. Because, see, when you have Jesus looking at it, when you see Jesus, the author and the finisher of faith, then Jesus comes alive in you and you look like Him. You look like Him. Come on, church. That's why we have to work on character flaws. We're not perfected. We're getting it. But, well, let's look at it this way. By faith, we're perfected, but we're moving every day. That's why character flaws. Well, I've learned so much about Jesus. I've learned so much His Word, and they don't look like Jesus. They don't act like Jesus. That's the person that is not going to walk in faith. It'll walk in works. Now, this is what I'm trying to tell you. When you're believing God for something and you're wanting to see that vision and you've got so much confusion, so much image of all kinds of other stuff, well, first of all, you better get your eyes on Jesus. I'm worshiping You, Father, not things. I'm worshiping You. God knows you need, let's say you need a house. God knows you need a car. Let's say God knows you need this. No, don't get your eyes on things. Get your eyes on Jesus. What are you doing? You're building your vision on Him, and you're creating now a love walk with Him that now you're starting to see Him, and now He's starting to talk to you, and now vision starts coming to you. Now you start seeing the way He sees. And listen to this. Write this down too. When you see Jesus, others will see Jesus. Even the unsaved one, even the enemy in the spiritual realm. So that means that Jesus now is in you, and they're seeing Jesus. I remember a story that my spiritual father said that he walked up to this ranch, and he said, "The Lord needs this property. The Lord needs this property, and I'm here to tell you, the Lord needs this property." Well, the man knew that the Lord was speaking to him already about that land. So what did he do? Gave him that land. Why? Because when he walked to that front porch, that man saw Jesus. Now I would say, boy, that'd be nice if everybody did it. No. You got to get that first word from God. If God says you do it, you do it. Can you imagine the boldness, Bo, going to somebody's house and say, God needs this house. It better be God. Or it's flesh. If it's flesh, you're destroyed. But if it's God, the knee-buckling experience comes. Yeah, God's been speaking to me about that too. Wow, I'm telling you, that's powerful. That's why it's so important to get that first word. Are y'all okay with that? Get that first word. Get that first word. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Get that first word. Get that first word. Oh, Jesus, this came way beyond with the written here word, but it's written. It's written. Amen. Go ahead and stand up, church. Amen. Go ahead and stand up. Hallelujah. Amen. Get that first word. Get that first word. And don't move from it. Don't move from it. If God gave you a first word, don't move from it. You know what I'm saying? How many times circumstances try to move us? Try to move, many times circumstances try to move you, but the first word will always. I remember when I stood up in that great church to receive my calling in a mantle, it was no sooner that same week that a friend of mine called and said, there's a job in Massachusetts waiting for you. You can go get it. They'll move you down. They'll bring the big haul and move you and pay a lot of money. I'm telling you, I knew. No. I know the first word of God. I'd heard the word called me into ministry. The word of the Lord came. So I'm not moved. I told that person, no. He said, you got to be kidding. And family said, why don't you do that while you're training? No, that's not what God said. Well, why don't you do that and save that money so that when you do go into ministry? No, God didn't say that. God said, do it now. So see, the first word always is important, right? So now I want you to start thinking about it. First word God said. First word God said. Stay in it. And if you need the first word again, then let God remind you. Or if you never heard a first word, and just keep looking to Jesus now. Look to Jesus. Say, Lord, I need to ask you, Lord, to direct me. Show me, Lord, but look to you. I look to you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I see you. Let's close our eyes. Amen.